It's Fiesta time in sunny Madrid, a festival for the world's best swimmers and divers. But the Americans are hardly in a party mood. They came to Spain with high expectations and instead have met only more frustration. One American who has not disappointed is Greg Louganis. And today, in the final day of competition, you'll see him go for a gold medal in the 10-meter platform. Another bright spot for the U.S. has been Betsy Mitchell. She won the 100-meter backstroke. And today, you'll see her try to duplicate that gold medal performance by capturing the 200-meter backstroke. For the Americans, today's competition offers a final chance for redemption. Seven gold medals are still up for grabs, and the United States is determined to bring them home. The World Swimming and Diving Championships are next on CBS Sports. Once again to El Centro de Natación, the last 2 weeks, the swimming capital of the world. Now we wait the start of the final day of competition here at the 5th World Swimming and Diving Championships. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jim Nantz, and the big story of this world championship has been the lackluster showing of the American swimmers. One of the East German coaches told us privately that they were afraid coming in that the United States would win every event. After all, the Americans had sent the B team to Moscow recently, and they did quite well. While the American A team was shattering world records at the trials in Orlando in June. But as you can see by the overall swimming count in the medals, that coming into this final day of competition, the East Germans have utterly dominated this meet, garnering 13 golds, 12 of which were earned by their awesome women's squad. But there have been some positive notes for the United States. Betsy Mitchell, the enthusiastic backstroker from Marietta, Ohio, she has already taken the gold in the 100, and today you'll see her swim for gold in her specialty, the 200 backstroke. Mary T. Maher also will compete in the race she dominates. She's the world record holder in the 200-meter butterfly, and we'll have that race for you also. And diver Greg Louganis has been, as usual, steady and spectacular. We'll see him dive for gold in the 10-meter platform competition when this special edition of Sports Sunday continues from Madrid here on CBS.
This special edition of CBS Sports Sunday is sponsored by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. McDonald's. It's a good time for the great taste of McDonald's. And by the U.S. Army, a place to be all you can be.
Finals of the men's platform diving championship from the diving well in Madrid. Of course, the favorite in this event is Greg Louganis, the phenomenal Greg Louganis, who has already now amassed four world championships, two gold medals in the Olympics. And with all of these titles, however, we found out recently from Greg, it hasn't been that easy.
Well, I wouldn't continue diving if I didn't feel like I could improve, like I'm getting better.
But how does Greg Louganis improve on a perfect 10? His list of achievements is unparalleled. More than 40 national titles, double Olympic gold, three world championships. But how did he get so good? Well, the road to the top was filled with detours. Greg Louganis, at age 3, was already a performer who enjoyed the spotlight. Louganis was adopted by Peter and Frances Louganis. It was Greg's mother, Frances, who helped start his diving career.
I started trying some of my gymnastic stunts off the diving board, and my mother told me that I was going to learn how to do it safely and I was going to learn how to do it correctly. So she got me lessons that summer.
By the time he was a teenager, Louganis was shooting for the Olympics. Louganis began training under Dr. Sammy Lee, a two-time Olympic gold medalist and a demanding taskmaster.
My father called up Dr. Lee and asked him if he would train me. I heard horror stories about his training techniques, that he threw wet footballs at his divers, that he had bamboo poles that he'd swing. He had a lot of unorthodox training methods, and that he was really tough. And I learned those stories were true, that he was tough, but he was somebody who had a big heart.
In the 76 Summer Olympics, 16-year-old Greg Louganis, the star of the future, and Dr. Sammy Lee, diving star of the past, joined forces to try and defeat the current star, Italy's Klaus DiBiase.
I heard about Klaus DiBiase, and all I knew was he was a pretty good diver. You know, I didn't know of his records. I didn't know that I was going up against a legend, you know. If I had known, I would have been scared to death.
DiBiase was trying to win his third consecutive gold medal in the platform and break Dr. Lee's record of two straight. When he nailed his final dive, the gold was his, and Louganis had to settle for second place.
I was kind of embarrassed. I mean, I know, you know, you think, God, a 16-year-old kid, a silver medalist in the Olympics, that's quite an accomplishment. But I went out to win.
But it was DiBiase who wore the gold. Louganis with the silver should have returned home a hero, but he didn't.
A lot of the people who I kind of hung out with in high school wouldn't have anything to do with me. Because they figured, you know, well, you know, he's gotten all this exposure, he's changed. I've always been shy, so I withdrew even more. And there was a time when I quit in 77 because I just didn't feel like it was worth it.
Louganis returned to diving in time for the 78 World Championships. And with Klaus DiBiase now retired, Louganis won the gold medal on the platform. The platform would soon become Louganis' most dangerous adversary. 10 meters high, 33 feet straight up, steel and concrete.
You do have a genuine fear of landing flat or possibly, you know, hitting your head or your feet or something on the platform. You always have to maintain a healthy respect for the platform. You can't ever get too comfortable, because that's when you make mistakes and that's when you get hurt.
In the Soviet Union in 1979, Louganis hits his head on the platform and crashes unconscious into the pool.
If I had remembered that I landed flat on my back and remembered the pain, then I would have been a lot more leery of going up there and doing the dive again. So I think I was lucky.
Edmonton, 1983. Soviet diver Sergei Shlibashvili is not so lucky. Competing against Louganis, he attempts a very difficult dive. He hits his head on the platform and later dies.
When it first happened and I was competing, I had to block that out of my mind, that it ever happened. I started blaming myself. For everybody to compete with me, they feel that they have to do these dives, and it's my fault. Then a friend of mine pointed out the fact that I didn't have a gun to his head, you know, forcing him to do the dive. So, you know, I got over that, blaming myself.
Orlando, Florida, this year. Louganis hits the platform with his foot. He dives safely into the water, unhurt, but finishes fifth in the meet. It was his first defeat in the platform competition in over 2 years.
My initial reaction coming up from the water was, all right, who moved the platform, you know? I mean, that was the reaction, because, you know, what can you do? I didn't get hurt. If anything was going to get hurt, it was my pride.
For Louganis, more than pride was hurt in 1980 when President Carter announced the boycott of the Summer Olympics in Moscow.
With Soviet invading forces in Afghanistan, neither the American people nor I will support sending an Olympic team to Moscow.
I just knew in my heart that we were going. And then when we were at the Olympic trials, I started crying because I realized then, not until then, that we weren't going anywhere.
Louganis had to wait 2 years to prove he was the best in the world. And in 1982, at the World Championships, he performed the perfect dive on the springboard, all tens, and he swept to gold medals in both the springboard and the platform.
I won the competition. I beat the Olympic champion by over 100 points, and that's, you know, that was kind of my saying to them, yeah, we weren't there.
Finally, in 1984, Lugaitis achieved his lifelong ambition, becoming an Olympic champion. He won gold medals in both the springboard and platform. But more importantly, the double gold elevated him to legendary status, alongside former mentor Dr. Sammy Lee and former rival Klaus DiBiase.
Winning the Olympics in 84, that was kind of a dream come true, especially the performance on platform. I could have retired at that time and felt good, but I'm glad that I didn't, because I still feel, looking back at the films, I know I can improve.
Olympic superstardom translated into commercial success and celebrity status. He became an instant pinup star, was in heavy demand for personal appearances, accepted the 1984 Sullivan Award as the country's outstanding amateur athlete, received induction into the Olympic Hall of Fame, and starred in a TV commercial.
Hey, I avoid sugar. That makes me feel good about me.
Feeling good about yourself, feeling carefree.
Luganis also began pursuing his other love, acting, with a bit part in the movie Dirty Laundry.
Hey, Jay Boy, is that you? How was the concert?
So what's left for Greg Luganis? How much more can the Perfect 10 improve? How many more records will he break? How many more gold medals will he win?
Records to break that I'd like to break. I'd like to break 800 on 3-meter springboard, and I would like to break 700 on 10-meter platform with the Russians and East Germans there. I haven't committed myself to the 1988 games because that's a big commitment. It's a major commitment, and I'm not ready to make that commitment yet. So I plan on doing that after the World Championships.
Phil Boggs is our diving expert, a former three-time world champion in his own right. Phil, is that all the platform event now has amounted to? Is a personal challenge for Greg Luganis against himself? Or is there actually a chance someone could upset him here?
Chances of someone upsetting him are pretty slim. Greg is performing. The question is, will he reach his goals, which are pretty lofty? But Greg has looked terrific in practice and was the leader after the preliminaries. Only if he falters will he be challenged. And that challenge will come from the Chinese, but maybe the toughest challenge will be from his own teammate, Olympic silver medalist Bruce Kimball.
And we'll join the gold medal competition in the men's platform diving final when we return to Spain in just a moment. Rounds of the men's platform final, it's shaping up as a battle between the Americans and the Chinese. Luganis of the United States is the leader. Kimball is fourth. This is Tong Wei of China, currently third after three dives.
Great entry. Round four is a continuation of the easy dives. They do four rounds where they demonstrate their basic skills in diving, then they move into the more difficult somersaulting and twisting dives. This is a basic reverse dive and near flawless entry.
Tong Wei, and he picks up exceptional marks. Nines for Tong Wei.
Remember, in diving, anything better than a seven indicates a good dive. Eight and a halves and nines is a terrific dive.
Sergei Gurilev of the Soviet Union, who is sixth right now through three dives.
And the Soviets this year in international competition have brought different divers into each of the events. They're testing out a number of young divers. Was a great entry, but he was short of vertical. His body was not straight when he hit the pool. The judges will take off for that.
How much do they take off for something like that?
Well, they'll probably take off 2 or 3 points. The entry certainly adds something because the entry is virtually perfect with no splash. You can see scores of 7, 7.5. They're good scores and indicates a good dive, but it will leave him substantially behind the leaders. It's a little warm pool where they go in to keep warm and relax in between the dives.
Bruce Kimball, who has been on the scene for the last 5 years, he won the bronze at the World Championships in Guayaquil 4 years ago.
That was great. Kimball has been Mr. Consistent. That's his father, who's also his coach, who was my coach back in the 76 Olympics.
Dick Kimball, he's the coach at the University of Michigan. Another look at Bruce Kimball.
This is still one of the easy dives. It's 1.5 somersaults with one twist and a perfect finish. Bruce has been Mr. Consistent in diving. He doesn't usually get nines and tens, but he hardly ever misses.
There he is with Dad going over the scores. He always knows where he stands in a match, too. He watches the scoreboard, unlike many others. Lee Kong Shang of China.
Same dive. Another great finish. He wasn't quite as straight as Bruce going in the water. So he really shouldn't get quite as high a marks.
He figures to be one of the top guys here who could threaten Greg Louganis for the top spot.
Well, he can do all the same dives that Greg does, and he's probably one of the only divers in the world that can.
So eights for Lee Kong Chang of China.
He's going over to his coach, which is Mike Brown, the diving coach at the University of Texas. Lee has spent the year training in Texas.
And he'll be enrolling at Texas this fall. Now, Greg Louganis, he has led since the first dive.
This is an inward 1.5 somersaults pike in the 82 World Championships. He got all 10s on this dive. Oh, just another great dive. You know, Greg's like a bowler that throws strikes after strikes, and whenever he misses, he throws a spare. He never misses by much. You can just see like an arrow going through the water. That gives you an indication of just how high up they are. It's 10 meters up. It's about 33 feet off the water.
And his coach, Ron O'Brien, as they see the marks, 8 fives and nines for Greg Louganis. That'll be good enough at the time. Keep him in the lead. There's his mother on the right. She's on hand. She was here also for the springboard to watch Greg take the gold in that competition. Through four rounds of the men's platform, it's the United States 1-2, Louganis and Kimball. And on the left has been the coach of Greg Louganis for the past 10 years. And they're right now to the side of the pool and talking about a little strategy as we enter the fifth round.
Even when you're as good as Greg is, you need to be coached throughout a contest. This is when the diving gets fun. This is six rounds of the most difficult somersaulting and twisting dives from 33 feet above the water. Somersaults in pike position. And you could see on the entry his body looked just a little bit loose, a little like he collapsed when he hit, and the judges will take off for that. This is a rock up in the sky. It's a piece of cement, and he's still got almost two somersaults done above it. A lot of splash on the end. They'll take off for that. Each of the divers must do six different optional dives. It's one from each of the six ways you can go off the platform. That was the front direction.
Sergei Gurilev of the Soviet Union.
This is the same dive we just saw. Not nearly as high a jump. He over-rotates the finish. That won't reach the good scoring level. That won't make sevens.
That was a difficulty factor of 3.0.
Well, you talk about the 3.0 degree of difficulty. Each of the dives have a rating. The judges themselves just judge the performance of the dive. They throw out the high and low scores, add the ones in the middle, and multiply by the degree of difficulty.
And now Bruce Kimball from the United States. He's moved up now to second after four dives. Concerned dad looking on. You know, I consider Bruce's comeback story one of the greatest comeback stories in all of sport.
In diving, he's known as the comeback kid after that automobile accident in 1981. And that was another good dive. Dad's happy with that one.
In that car accident, he broke every bone in his face, fractured his skull, broke his leg. His weight dropped from 140 to 100 pounds. It's amazing he's still alive, much less diving. And even more amazing, he came back that year within 7 months and was diving again on his way to a bronze medal the next year at the World Championships.
You know, and 1 month after that, he beat Greg Louganis at our national championships.
Bruce Kimball. And now Lee Kong Chang, 27, the elder statesman of the Chinese diving team.
He's capable of doing great dives, and he's had some great competitions with Greg Louganis, but Greg always seems to win at the end.
You know, I mentioned Greg as being like a bowler that throws strikes and when he misses, throws spares. Lee Kong Ching is capable of throwing strikes, but he also can blow one completely.
The marks for Kong Chang, 7-5 to 8-5 here.
Excellent scores on a dive that carries a high degree of difficulty. He'll move closer to Greg in the standings.
Now Greg Louganis, the leader. Now, how difficult is this? To me, this it looks extremely difficult, but they don't have it that high on the degree of difficulty.
Well, every 10-year-old gymnast can do a handstand. Now the difference is put yourself 33 feet up with nothing in front of you. So it's pretty difficult to get in the handstand, but the mechanics of the trick that they're doing, the somersaults they're doing off of this, they have rated not as high. Great dive again from Louganis. But each of the divers must do a handstand optional, and each of these divers at this level will do the same optional that Greg's doing. You can see that he only misses the tower by a foot. It goes straight in. This gives you the diver's eye view of somersaulting back toward the platform from 33 feet up. Yeah, you see Greg smiling and happy there with those 8.5s and 9s. Greg has seemed relaxed and smiling throughout the competition here.
Well, he already has one goal. That's from the springboard competition. He's going for double gold here in the platform. We're halfway through the men's platform, and he continues to lead. Kong Shang has moved up to second. Our coverage of the final day of competition will continue in just a moment. Don't forget, later on in our broadcast, you'll be seeing Betsy Mitchell, the world record holder in the 200 back, competing in her specialty, as well as Mary T. Maher, Madam Butterfly, competing in the butterfly event. Both are big hopes for the United States. And Matt Biondi will be anchoring the men's medley relay. All of that will be coming up later in our show from Madrid. When we come back, we'll be seeing more diving here at the World Swimming and Diving Championships. For the next round of competition, you know, he does not like to follow his other competitors, and he's here, he told us, listening to a Spanish radio station that's playing American Top 40.
You know, Greg has brought a different dimension to sport. You can see him stretching out here. He's the only diver that we know that has a dance background, and it shows in how graceful he's able to perform his dives.
Many of the divers have a gymnastic background, but Tong Wei of China had no formal training before he started diving. He's now 23 years old. Last year's World Platform Diver of the Year.
Yes, he was a World Platform Diver of the Year in the year that Greg Louganis chose not to compete internationally. That was Greg's year of relaxing after the Olympics. This is the reverse direction. He's going to somersault 2.5 times back toward the platform. Remember I said each of the divers must do all six directions. You can see there he only misses the tower by about a foot. A lot of splash in the bottom, so they take off some for that.
Sevens for Tong Wei of China.
Again, each of the divers will go to their coach in between the rounds. What did I do wrong on that dive? What do I have to think about on the next one?
Gurilev of the Soviet Union, high DD here, degree of difficulty, 3.4.
We just saw Tong Wei do reverse 2.5 somersaults. This is reverse 3.5 somersaults. This is the dive that one of the Soviet divers at the World University Games hit his head on the platform and died. Can see that's a lot of dive to get in just a little over 2 seconds, and he just about made it. 3.5 somersaults, just not quite making 3.5 before he hits the pool.
Low marks for Gurilev of the Soviet Union.
But with that high a degree of difficulty, someone like Bruce Kimball would have to do a dive for scores about a point higher to stay even.
Example here, he's trying a dive, degree of difficulty 2.6.
So he'll have to get scores here of 7.5.
Phil, he's using the side of the platform here. He's not taking off from the middle.
Well, this is just diver's preference, whatever they feel is the best for them getting a grip on the platform. Bruce has got a great handstand, very steady. slowly and was straight in, but he didn't get that rip entry. You can see a little kip off the platform. That's that almost springing off your hands. A lot of splash, and they'll take off some for that.
Another look at Bruce Kimball. And the marks for Kimball, not his best, ranging from 6'5 to 8.
But still consistent.
Lee Kongshang in second place through 5 of the 10 dives. High degree of difficulty here, Phil, 3.3.
This is the back direction, and he's chosen to do the most difficult somersaulting optional in the back direction. It's 3.5 somersaults backwards. He and Greg do this. These are the dives that make the difference in a competition.
Is there anything at all wrong with this dive? It looks like a perfect 10.
Maybe at the very start he has a little bit of flat feet, falls back just a fraction, but a perfect entry. You can expect a lot of nines at least on this one. That is a great dive. We'll get him a lot of points.
A lot of points because of the high degree of difficulty. Nines were the average, and Coach Ron O'Brien of the United States knows now that the pressure turns to Greg Louganis. A lot of points there for Lee Kongshang.
Well, this really does put the pressure on because they're doing these difficult dives. If he does a couple of them like that, he will be right with Greg to the end of this competition. Now, this dive for Greg is a twisting optional. Each of the divers have to do one of these. He's chosen to do a reverse 1.5 somersaults with 3.5 twists. It's the most difficult twisting dive any of the divers use in competition. He's taken the pressure well, but that was not as good a dive as Lee Kongshang. You saw the difference in the entry. He had splash on his entry. In the USA International a few months ago, Greg hit the platform with his feet on this dive, got 0 points, and dropped a fifth. That competition was won by Lee Kongshang. You can see on this one, he's jumped substantially away from the tower to be safe, but it's not as good a dive.
Boy, the scores, 8s and 8.5s for Louganis, and with the lower degree of difficulty, not nearly as many points in this round as Lee Kongshang. A new leader through 6 of 10 rounds. Lee Kongshang has taken the lead. This is not a position that Greg Louganis is accustomed to being in. 4 dives to go. He's in second place. Leader through 6 dives in the men's platform final, Lee Kongshang of China. Who would have thought that Greg Louganis of the United States would be behind this deep into the competition? He was the biggest lock for a gold medal here in Madrid coming into the competition.
And it's not that Greg's diving poorly. Greg is diving very well. He's being outdived by the Chinese. Earlier during the week, we've seen the Chinese do great dives and win both women's events.
This is Tong Wei of China. This diving team from China, through 3 diving events, have claimed 2 golds, 3 silvers, and a bronze. They have been the far superior unit here.
You know, we saw them at the 82 World Championships when they were the favorites. They didn't perform well. They certainly are performing great here.
And another one.
That was a perfect entry, but the takeoff of that dive was not good, and they will take off points for that. Watch his feet come apart at the beginning. See his legs bend and his feet come apart. But a great entry.
8s and 8.5s for Tong Wei of China.
And that dive carries a degree of difficulty of 3.2.
So that'll pick up a lot of points for him.
You can see, even as good as that dive was, the Chinese coach is right on top of him, telling him how to do it better and that's how to get ready for the next one.
Xu Yiming, we saw him coach Gao Ming to start off the diving competition a week ago to a gold medal in the women's springboard. He's been the Chinese diving coach only since April. What a performance by his team here in Madrid. Gurilev of the Soviet Union.
and he had a tough act to follow. That was the exact same dive. It was 1.5 somersaults backwards with 3.5 twists. And he just over-rotates the somersault. And it's actually a little bit off angle.
Dives like that, point totals like that, hurt you in this point of a competition.
When the top divers are doing great dives, you have to do a great dive to just keep up with them.
Bruce Kimball of Ann Arbor, Michigan. He's back to fourth place now through six dives.
This is a low degree of difficulty dive. He must get scores at least a point higher than the other divers just to stay even. Oh, that was great. That was the perfect entry. Absolutely no splash. Remember I said he needed like 8 to 8.5 to stay even. He should outscore them with this one. Now you'll see Greg Louganis do 3.5 somersaults in this direction later, but this is perfect on 2.5.
8.5 to 9.5 for Kimball.
Well, I agree. His dad said and his coach said, you can't do it any better than that, and I don't see how they took off what they did.
Now Lee Kong Chang. He's the leader now. We'll see how he adapts to being in first place. Comes right back with a very tough dive. Difficulty factor 3.4.
Well, this is the hardest somersaulting dive in this direction. We saw Kimball do reverse 2.5 somersaults. This is reverse 3.5 somersaults. Another good dive. You can see his feet flat on the entry, and they'll take off for that. But it was still a good dive. He's still keeping the pressure on. You can see how his feet are flat. Right as he hits the water, gets a little bit of splash, but that's still a very good dive. That is a lot of dive to finish in 2 seconds.
Ranging from 8 to 9, and again, multiplied by that high degree of difficulty, big points for the leader. And Greg Louganis with a lower degree of difficulty, still it's a 3.2 DD here. He would need almost a perfect dive to overtake the leader.
And this is the most difficult somersaulting dive you can do in this direction. It's in toward the platform. He's capable of it, but at our national championships 2 weeks ago, he missed this dive. Ooh, that's a little bit short of vertical there too. Got a lot of splash. The judges are gonna take off for that. Kong Chang is going to increase his lead. You can see it's described as 3.5 somersaults. He has to be all the way straight, and he is not straight when he hits the water.
Oh, sevens and 7.5s for Louganis. So he will not stay up to the standard set before him by Lee Kong Chang.
Well, he's going to drop over 20 points behind on that dive.
Going into this round, he was 6 points down, and now Lee Kong Chang of China has upped that lead to 23 points. Only three dives to go, and Greg Louganis, arguably the greatest diver of all time, trails in the competition. Lee Kong Chang of China pulling the upset at the moment. We'll be right back. It's team and Dr. Sammy Lee here lending his support.
Well, Dr. Lee was one of Greg's first coaches and helped him to that silver medal in the Olympics in 1976 before Ron O'Brien took over as his coach.
Louganis trailing with three dives to go in the platform competition. Klaus DiBiase, 1976, he won the gold medal at the Olympics in the platform. That is the last time that Louganis has not won a world championship or an Olympic competition. Louganis was only 16 then. Xu Yingming, the Chinese diving coach, they've already won two of the three gold medals here in Madrid, and they're going for a third. This is Tong Wei in medal contention.
This is an arm stand optional. It's the same optional we saw Louganis do earlier in the competition. He's in trouble coming back toward the platform. That was a near disaster on the platform, and the dive is a total disaster. He should have stopped on the platform. Watch how close his head comes to hitting the platform and his feet. You can see as he falls through, his feet just about tip, but his head almost hits. He's allowed to stop on the platform, take the dive over again. He'll lose points from the judges for that, but at least save himself.
How painful is this?
It's a little bit like a boxer getting hit by a jab. They're used to it, so it doesn't hurt too much to the diver. But to any one of the people sitting in the stands, it'll probably knock him out.
Well, he's up and walking, and he'll continue to compete. It looks like he'll be eliminated from medal contention. Gurilev of the Soviet Union now.
And he's doing the same dive. This has got to scare him, knowing what just happened. You can hear the crowd still hasn't settled down from that, and now they see another handstand coming up. A lot of hesitation there. Oh, and not a good dive. The divers must come up in that arm stand and show control. They have to show that stop position. There's no fixed time, but you've got to show control. He really didn't quite stop, and he certainly lets go of the rotation too soon. A lot of splash.
So the door is now open for Bruce Kimball.
This is where doing those easier dives has paid off for Kimball, because he's been able to do them very well each time. Now, we saw earlier Lee Kong Cheng do back 3.5 somersaults. Kimball is doing back 2.5 somersaults.
At the Olympics in 84, he came from behind to beat Lee Kong Cheng. And also Tong Wei beat him out for the silver medal. Door is open now for Kimball.
Another great dive. He's stepping into the doorway, that's for sure.
Another perfect entry also.
But that's what he's been known for, having great entries. You can see he doesn't somersault very fast and finishes just above the water, but a perfect entry. He falls back a little bit far from the platform. But perfect entry.
Eight fives and nines for Kimball.
You can see his dad's coaching him for the next dive already.
Lee Kong Cheng, he is still the leader here. We're in the eighth round, 10 dives in all.
This is an inward 3.5 somersaults. This is the one Louganis did in the last round for 6.5s and sevens and dropped 20 points back. It's on your toes, 33 feet up, somersaulting 3.5 times towards the platform. Oh, that's a complete miss. You can see how fast he spins. He actually somersaults faster than Louganis. That's Louganis' mother watching that. Watch how fast he somersaults. Almost two at the platform. Let's go early. Total over rotation and enough splash to wet the 5 meter.
Yes, high tide in Madrid. The pressure starting to mount here. We've seen everyone miss their dive in this round except for Kimball.
Well, again, it's a little bit like somebody bowling. You got to keep throwing strikes to win, especially when this man is the competition.
Coach Ron O'Brien looking on. Good dive here for Louganis could put him back in front.
Back in the lead. That was 3.5 somersaults, Pike. It just looked like he was out for a Sunday stroll. He makes these difficult dives look easy. That power and grace, that dance training he's had, makes them look easy. And another great entry.
8 fives and nines for Greg Louganis. Right when he needed it.
Hear the whistles from the crowd. They think it was better than that.
Well, the New Zealand judge gave him a 7.5.
Well, he did spin a little bit slow, but it was a great dive.
So Lee Kong Cheng now falls back in the second, and Greg Louganis has taken back the lead. What a round it was for the Americans. Two dives to go. is dropped to sixth as we enter the ninth round. That disastrous dive opening the door for Bruce Kimble for medal possibilities. Way actually just lucky to survive that one.
Now, he was very close to a disaster, not only from the dive, but to his ability to continue to compete. And now he's doing an inward 3 1/2 somersaults.
Good comeback.
It was a good dive, just a little bit short of vertical. He still looks a bit shaken up there diving. He's going to push back a little bit further than he might ordinarily do and leave the somersault just a little short of vertical. So it's a good dive, but that's not going to be the 8 1/2s and 9s that he needs to move back up in medal contention.
When you miss a dive like Tong Wei did in round 8, your confidence has to suffer a very large jolt.
But you can't take a break because they're doing the most difficult dives that can be done off the platform.
Now, Gurilev also missed in the last round.
And he's doing the same dive Tong Wei did again. It's an inward 3 1/2 somersaults. And it looked like a replay of Tong Wei's dive. Again, just a little bit short of vertical, a little bit back away from the platform. You see, he falls back just a little bit. And he's not completely straight when he hits. You have to be completely straight. So it's a good dive. It's right on that verge, that edge of 7 to 7 1/2, which makes it a good dive, but certainly not a great dive.
So Bruce Kimble has now moved up to third place. He just keeps moving along, not missing any dives, getting his 8s and 9s, occasionally a 9. Usually in the 7.5 to 8.5 range.
Now we saw the last two divers do inward 3 1/2 somersaults. Again, Kimball's doing an inward 2 1/2 somersaults. Oh, I hesitate because it was a very good dive, but he had a lot of splash on the entry. He must have missed his hands on the entry. You need to grab them to get that great entry that he's noted for. But you can watch, he's perfectly straight up and down. That part of the dive is great. But a lot of splash, so it drops it back into the barely good category. Should get about 7 1/2s.
7 to 8 for Bruce Kimble.
And you can see his dad, his coach, telling him, look like you missed your hands a little bit on the entry.
All right, now, just two dives to go. Kong Sheng obviously needs to put the pressure back on Louganis with a big one here.
Well, he needs to put the pressure on in two ways. He's doing a much lower degree of difficulty dive than Greg, so he's got to do the dive perfect just to stay even. You can see Ron O'Brien smiling, knowing that Greg is in good position right now. A great handstand. A little bit off on that one too. You can see flat feet and a little bit of splash back toward the platform. There he's perfect. Little flat feet while he's somersaulting, and watch when he hits, he flattens them again and they kick over. He over rotates.
Marks ranging from a 6.5 to an 8. He needed better than that, though, ninth round.
What that's going to do is maybe open the door for Kimble to move into silver medal position.
Now, Louganis, difficulty factor 3.3. A big one here could really put him in great shape going into the final dive.
The only thing that makes it interesting at this point is the fact that Greg is doing these difficult dives. He still has to do them well. Will put him comfortably in the lead.
What a great jump he got off the platform here, Phil.
Well, he's noted for his great jump. He doesn't spin nearly as fast as the Chinese divers, but a big jump and a controlled spin. He watches 1, 2, 3, kicks out, and is straight in.
Well, the smile on his face tells the story. It was in the next to last dive in the springboard that really locked up the competition there. And here another big one with only one dive to go. Louganis has, well, even his mother can figure it out now. He has taken a huge lead. 36 points in front of Lee Kong Shang. Bruce Kimble is in medal contention. Back after these messages and a word from your local stations. Go in the men's platform final. Greg Louganis has come back strong to take a big lead. Bruce Kimble, however, of the United States, he has moved up to third, but he has got to be feeling the pressure. He wants that silver medal here.
In the Olympics, he was able to come back in his final dive and take that silver medal. You can see Greg looks pretty relaxed right now. He's just performing now. He knows he's got a comfortable lead.
Tong Wei, China, fourth entering the final round.
But we're still doing difficult dives. This is the last of the optional dives. These all carry high degree of difficulty factors.
It's amazing to think that at 84's Olympics in Los Angeles, the order was Louganis, Kimball, Lee Kong Shang, and then Tong Wei, the same four battling it out 2 years later in Madrid.
Nope.
That's not going to win you any medals there.
No, it's another fault of the earlier disaster in the arm stand when he almost hit the platform. He just hasn't quite gotten his composure back.
Well short.
And that will definitely leave him out of medal contention.
Tong Wei. One dive told the story for him here. Now Gurilev in eighth place. He has slipped.
Well, the Soviets have brought a young team to these championships, and they've experimented bringing different divers throughout the international competitions this year, and they still haven't found their man or their woman yet. That was the same dive Tong Wei did, and considerably better. You could see he was able to finish all 3.5 rotations before he hit the pool.
Well, a good finish for Gurilev. And as you mentioned, the Soviets still searching, really, for their diving answers. And perhaps this is one of their answers for the future. Now, Bruce Kimble. Big dive here. Third entering the final round. He's trailing Lee Kong Shang for the silver.
And he saved his most difficult dive for last. 3.2 degree of difficulty, and he does it well. Excellent.
Well, he's certainly locked up at least the bronze here, and he's put the pressure on Lee Kong Chang. Your thoughts on the scores?
I thought they were about right. He was just a fraction short of vertical, but it was a great dive and a great finish. 8.5 is what you'd expect.
Congratulations from teammates Mark Bradshaw and Kelly McCormick. And now for Kimball, the question is it good enough for a silver or a bronze? This man holds the answer to that.
And he saved for his final dive a twisting optional also. Only Lee Kong Chang and Greg Louganis do reverse 1.5 somersaults with 3.5 twists. You saw Kimball do it backwards. It was 3.2 degree of difficulty. This is 3.3. Silver medalist, at least.
Xu Yingming, Ron O'Brien. Different thoughts running through their minds. O'Brien knows now that Louganis must execute. Good scores for Lee Kong Chang, over 80 points.
The pressure on Greg Louganis is not to do a great dive, but to complete a dive. His final dive is 3.4 degree of difficulty. We know it's the dive the Soviet diver died on in Canada a few years ago. He must complete the dive.
Último salto de la competición. Last dive of this competition. Salta Gregory Louganis.
Mom's looking on. You know, I get the feeling Greg really enjoys being in this position right here.
He's performing. This is Greg Louganis at his best when he's in this position.
Gold medal for Greg Louganis. They don't even have to wait to see the scores on that one. Dr. Sammy Lee in the background. Ron O'Brien, his coach for the last 10 years. Double gold for Greg Louganis, his fifth world championship. He adds on to an incredible resume that is already second to no one in diving history. Today, the mark of a true champion as he comes from behind to win the gold. Bronze for Bruce Kimble. And we'll be back to Madrid in just a moment. Swimming on this, the final day of competition. The Spaniards have embraced these championships, and they're hoping for more. They're hoping for the Olympics in 1992. Our CBS Sports colleague, Ann Butler, has more on sports in Spain.
It's an observation the natives are quick to confirm. Participatory sport here is largely defined in terms of weekend leisure. It's like former U.S. Open winner Manuel Orantes and two-time Masters champion Seve Ballesteros. Plus, there are other names, local legends who are idolized on playgrounds everywhere.
Who's your favorite sports hero? ¿Quién es tu heroísta favorita de deportes?
Butragueño.
Santillana. Butragueño.
More than just folk heroes, Butragueño and Santa Ana are practically legends on the soccer field because for the most part, soccer, or football as they call it here, is professional sports in Spain. Although this year's World Cup was something of a disappointment when Spain lost to Belgium in the quarterfinals in Mexico City, the fans remain passionate. I mean, even now, during the offseason, there are no less than, count them, three daily newspapers devoted exclusively to sports news. We are talking national pastime here. Just to give you an idea, this is the home of Real Madrid, the capital city's favorite sons. Capacity crowd here, well over 100,000, and even at that, it's still not the biggest stadium in Spain. But the heart and soul of Spanish sport is still the bullfight. More art than sport, the Spaniards maintain a tradition of form and ritual deeply ingrained in the national psyche. Bullfighting does list its famous fans. Hemingway was always a fixture at bullfight arenas. And Pablo Picasso found artistic inspiration in its pageantry and spectacle. Maybe, after all, we Americans can relate. If not to the fight, then perhaps to all this fascination with the bull. How about those Bulls from Chicago and the talented leader of the herd, a guy named Michael Jordan? In baseball, take note of Bull Durham. And of course, there was another Chicago Bull named Lozinski, whose homers usually sent visiting managers to call upon their bullpens in search of new hope. Wall Street, of course, hired Madison Avenue to talk to us about being bullish on America. And don't forget, Teddy Roosevelt ran for president as a bull moose. But here in Spain, the humor is lost. Most tourists agree it's the bull who gets the bum steer.
Well, I don't know that it's really sport. I find it rather cruel and unusual and inhumane treatment of animals, frankly.
I think it was terrible.
Why?
Why? They tried to kill the bull several times and they didn't make it.
Well, here's a look at one bull who did make it, thanks to a large non-Spanish audience and some protective padding on his back. At the opening ceremonies to these world championships, contrary to custom, the bull was allowed to live. While El Toro proudly took his bows, foreigners in the crowd delightedly took it in, and an outraged Madrid press strongly took offense.
So they tried to present the nicest part of bullfighting, but it was a fake part. It was not a question of being nice or not being nice, but it was fake.
There's certainly nothing fake about this, the running of the bulls through the streets of the town of Pamplona, a mad dash leading a furious herd of stampeding horns, and an annual rite of passage for some forms of young manhood that still just isn't. isn't what it used to be.
I mean, so many people that it has even become a problem. And the old runners, say the ones that used to do it in Hemingway days,
right,
are now desperate because, you know, there's not even space to run.
So if the logic of some types of Spanish sports still escape you, consider this. Facing a herd of angry bulls just can't be any worse than facing a blitz of angry bears, can it? Ole.
The pool is being prepared for the final evening of swimming competition, and the Americans think this will be a big one for them. The schedule seems to favor them. Then, coming up next on CBS Sports, you'll see the World Series of Golf from Akron, Ohio. We'll be back to Madrid to get the swimming underway in just a moment. Before the swimming competition, the award ceremony for gold medal winning Greg Louganis. So the American anthem is played for the first time on this, the final day of competition at the World Championships. And I say the first time because there could be more gold on the way. Our swimming expert, John Neighbor, joins us now at the broadcast position. And John, you feel very confident here on the final day with the schedule of events for the American swimmers.
At least that's the attitude we're getting from the American coaches, because the World Championship schedule has not been conducive to the American strengths. And so it's only in the last day of competition that the Americans could easily be favored in more than half of the events we'll see. In the six events competed in the final day of competition, America could win three, maybe even four gold medals, and that's very good. Also, throughout the week, Americans have been reluctant to show their patriotism because of fear of possible terrorist reprisals. Well, all that fear has been put aside on the final day of competition as the red, white, and blue flags and banners come to the forefront. We'll see a lot of spirit and a lot of good swimming coming up.
The women's 200-meter butterfly, the world and American record held by Mary T. Maher of Louisville, Kentucky. She has dominated this event for years. She has the 10 fastest 200 flies of all time. But here in Madrid, this will be her sixth event. So far, she has come up empty-handed in the gold department, three silver medals and two bronze. But this definitely is her best chance at gold at the World Championships. Mary T. Maher, Madam Butterfly, she is better known as to her teammates. Here's a chance, though, to meet Mary T. Maher of the United States. Mary T. Maher has been part of the swimming scene since 1979. She owns the 10 fastest times ever in the 200-meter butterfly, the first one coming back when she was just 14 years old.
I was out a little slower than we wanted me to be, but I did okay. I know when I first set the world record, I took a lot of it for granted, or maybe it's something you just can hardly believe, but the last time I set those records were in 1981, and I don't think I'd take them for granted anymore.
After 17 years of the swimming grind, this 21-year-old is starting to diversify her interests.
I don't know if I really get bored. I guess, yeah, sometimes I do get bored. I mean, I start thinking about other things I'd rather be doing, and, you know, especially sometimes you start getting caught up in your social life, and yet you can't keep a good social life going all the time if you're really swimming seriously. But, I mean, I'll be real honest with you, and I'm real tired of swimming a lot of the times, and I have to evaluate and reevaluate and remind myself why I am swimming.
The boredom comes from the endless laps and countless hours of practice. Not only did her body grow tired, but her mind had good reason to wander. For just when you're set to compete against the world's best, and then that opportunity is suddenly taken away from you by events on the other side of the globe, it hurts.
I have notified the Olympic Committee that with Soviet invading forces in Afghanistan, neither the American people nor I will support sending an Olympic team to Moscow.
They held a ceremony back in 1980 for the U.S. Olympic team and gave everyone a nice medal. But it just wasn't the same. At least there was 1984 to look forward to.
This is a CBS News special report.
The Soviet Union, without ever actually using the word, said it is boycotting the 1984 Games in Los Angeles.
It kind of was a knife in my back and in my heart. So, you know, it was hard. It's still hard to understand exactly what happened and what's going on.
Mary T. was happy, winning 3 gold medals in the 84 Olympic Games. But without competition from the Soviets and East Germans, it wasn't the same. So Mary T. keeps at it, keeps churning out the laps. It's the plight of women swimmers, and it seems to have always been that way. You swim and swim, and then one day it's all over. The career of other female athletes is much different. For unlike swimmers, they have a pro tour where financial rewards provide some incentive to continue. Even Madison Avenue tends to look at other women and other sports to endorse products. For male swimmers, from the days of Buster Crabbe on to Steve Lundquist, the fates have always been kinder. But for women swimmers, their moment of the sun is all too brief. Swimming has allowed Mary T. Maher to travel the world. Soon she'll have time to stop and smell the roses.
It's hard traveling in a huge team to always be able to sightsee and look around a country as much as you really would like to. And I've been to many places in Europe, but I haven't seen a whole lot besides a lot of swimming pools and a lot of hotels.
To compound the problems of boredom are the pressures of being a champion. From early in her life through today, Mary T. has been expected to win, and at times it gets to her.
Sometimes it's just a matter of feeling like everybody's watching me and everyone's touching me and everyone wants a part of me, and I need to crawl up into a cocoon every once in a while and kind of put my feet back on the ground, or, you know, or just to be 21 and, yeah, I mean, go out with people my age and stay out late, not having to worry about how I feel in the morning or what time I wake up.
You can't blame Mary T. for feeling this way. How would you like to be 21 and spending 5 hours a day working at your hometown pool when all around you are reminders that there are different ways to enjoy one summer? As Mary T. grows older, she gets wiser, and thankfully her practice time has been reduced.
She knows her body so well, and she knows the things that she needs to do. And when she comes in one day and just says, I'm tired, I'm really not ready today, we'll adjust her workout accordingly and let her do something else.
It's not as if there's no fun or joy in her life. She still finds the time to remain a kid. But even as she enjoys herself outside of the water, Mary T. is also looking forward to the challenge of the World Championships.
Ever since I heard of the boycott in 1984, immediately the World Games became, you know, the meet for me to point towards and retire at.
Retirement? For many athletes, retirement is a dirty word, something to be avoided. But for Mary T., retirement, if not after the World Championships, then certainly after the Olympics, is something to look forward to.
I have no idea how many more years I'll be swimming. I think it's going to be one of those days where I wake up and think, I really don't want to go to practice, and I'll never go back to the pool. You know, once I quit swimming, the more out of shape I get, I'll think, oh my gosh, how did I ever do that?
And Mary T. Maher qualified first in the morning heats by more than 2 seconds over the next time. She'll be in lane 4.
You know, her world record time of 2.05.96 is such a fantastic performance. And in fact, it's probably been a monkey on her back because it was so fast, she's not been able to touch that time for quite a while. At the national championships where she turned in that world record, she beat half of the men competing in the same event. beat half of the men at the U.S. National Championships, that woman's performance will last for a long time to come.
Well, she's really the veteran of the women's team for the United States at age 21, which isn't all that old. She's been around for a long time, however, on the international scene. The rest of the lane assignments, aside from Maher in lane four, right in lane five alongside his teammate, Kara McGrath of Birmingham, Michigan, who was the second qualifier to Maher in the prelims.
Well, let's not overlook these Germans. Lane one at the top, lane seven towards the bottom. They've performed very well at this meet. They have to be contenders.
This will be four lengths of the pool.
And a great start by lane seven, Birte Wiegang from East Germany. She went out with Mary T for the first of four lengths of the butterfly in the preliminaries, and she faded towards the end.
Oddly enough, Wiegang was ranked second in the world last year in the 100 back, but she only made her East German team in this event, the 200 butterfly. She has the lead at the moment as we near the 50-meter mark of this 200-meter race.
The butterfly is one of the most difficult of the competitive strokes because both arms are recovering out of the water at the same time. So at no point do you get to rest any one shoulder or any part of the upper body. So it's always working, and that's Mary T's strength. She can continue that pace.
Well, both of the East Germans had a hard time qualifying this morning. Cornelia Gressler in lane one and Birte Wiegang in lane seven. But right now they are 1-2 near the halfway point of this race.
World record split is a 101.41. I'd be very surprised even to see these Germans ahead of the split at the 100.
Maher now moving up into second.
She's going to have to make a move. She can't count on Birte Wiegang dying as she did in the preliminaries. And this third 50 is Mary T's greatest strength. She trains more butterfly than any two other athletes we know. I mean, she does a great deal of her workouts in the butterfly stroke.
Since 1977, she's competed in this event 45 times. She has won 44 of them, and she now has the lead. Mary T. Maher of the United States in lane four.
Look how she snaps her arms out of the water and swings them cleanly around into the front entry. She's always doing the dolphin motion, up and down with the shoulders and the hips in opposite directions.
Maher in front, Wiegang of East Germany in lane seven is second, and McGrath of the United States is in third.
Mary T looks good and smooth, long and strong.
All out now for Mary T. Maher, bringing home the gold. She's been in six events. This will be her sixth medal, but gold for the first time for Madame Butterfly. And the race for the silver, lane one, Cornelia Gressler of East Germany. Kara McGrath of the United States was just edged out for the bronze medal.
With about 75 meters to go, you can see Mary T. Maher in the center of the screen. Look how smooth and graceful she is as she executes the butterfly. Once again, it's all that butterfly training her coaches make her do. In fact, I think it's the sport itself has probably got to be getting old for her. She's continually looked upon as having to win the butterfly events. She said this might be her last international competition. She does plan to continue to swim for her college, Cal Berkeley, because she likes the team camaraderie in the college system. But this may be her last butterfly event internationally, and she goes out with a bang. Once again, look at her. Nice, smooth undulation through the water and a good, strong movement there in the upper right-hand corner of the screen.
So Madame Butterfly, she'll be a senior this year at Cal Berkeley. She has a gold medal. She medals in all six events here at the World Championships. And look at the smile on her face. And if this is her final race in international competition, that is one whale of a way to go out.
And a happy smile for her teammates.
Haven't been too many smiles here in Madrid for the American women.
Actually, Mary T. did a little bit of smiling after getting a bronze in the 200 freestyle, and that unnerved the American squad. They're unaccustomed to seeing Mary T. happy in third place.
So the final results, Mary T. Maher with the gold medal performance. Was not world record setting, but it was still an outstanding showing by Madame Butterfly. And Kara McGrath, well, she finishes fourth. Let's go down now to Phil Boggs, who has the gold medalist, Mary T. Maher.
T, congratulations. We saw a smile before the race began. Were you confident of this one?
Yeah, I was pretty confident. I was warming up really well and, you know, feel like I have all my strength back and
And I really thought I was going to go a good one.
Well, you made some comments about a 21-year-old wanting to return to a more normal life. Is this the last international swim for you?
No, it's not my last. I won't make any commitments of what will be my last one, or you know, whether or not I'll go for 88, but I'm having too much fun right now. There's too much in it for me to quit now.
Terrific. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Next up, America's Betsy Mitchell. We'll be back after this word from your local stations. Competition at the World Swimming and Diving Championships. We're now set for the women's 200-meter backstroke, an event that the East Germans had dominated prior to this year. Fastest times of all time until Betsy Mitchell of Marietta, Ohio, broke through with a world and American record. Mitchell already has one gold at these championships. She's now going for her second. Marietta, Ohio, population 12,000, is the type of town that most people would like to call home. It's a river town where it's quite easy to pass the time of day. Then, as now, young kids head over to the YMCA to learn how to swim. For Betsy Mitchell, Marietta was more than a home. It was a way of life.
I like it because it's unassuming. The people aren't, you know, hurried. They're just relaxed and laid back and living their lives. And in Marietta, everybody knows me. I know everybody. You know, that everyone's interested in what I'm doing, and not just because I'm Betsy Mitchell, the swimmer.
But to make it as a swimmer, Betsy left Marietta, ending up at the University of Texas. And this summer, at the U.S. team trials for the World Championships, she set a world record in the 200-meter backstroke. What makes her record so special is it's the first one set by an American woman since 1981.
I can't say that it's a great honor. I mean, it's not. It is an honor, but it's not the ultimate for me in my life. Yes, it may be the ultimate for me in my swimming life, but it's not the ultimate for me as a person.
Not as a person. That answer typifies Betsy Mitchell. For as important as swimming is to her, it's not everything.
There's Betsy the student, and there's Betsy the dancer. There's someone that likes being with other people, likes exploring relationships.
One relationship she's exploring is with Nathan, who also swims for the University of Texas.
If you just walked in on a swim practice, other than the fact that she's probably out swimming most of the people in the pool, you'd never know from her personality or from the way people treat her what she's accomplished.
They're going to think that we laugh a lot during practice, and we don't ever laugh during practice.
I always laugh at you.
With her personality, perhaps it's just as well that her specialty is the backstroke.
I like it because I don't have to get my face wet. Backstroke, I think, is one of the easier strokes to swim right. The harder things about it are that you are going backwards. It's not a natural thing. You know, people aren't used to not seeing where they're going. Why am I so good in the backstroke? I have no idea.
Don't let her country humor fool you. She's willing to put in the time and effort to become a champion. But questions still remain.
I think Betsy does have the mind of a champion, but to be honest with you, that still remains to be seen.
The East German women have dominated swimming for 7 years. Betsy Mitchell represents a breakthrough for the Americans in the backstroke. She beat the East Germans last December, and now she won't settle for anything less than gold in Madrid.
Winning is fine, but losing is not fine. I don't like to lose. I don't have that much practice at it.
She gained some practice at it in 1984 at the Olympics when she came away with a silver medal. But just the same, they still considered her a conquering hero back in Marietta. They held a day in her honor, named a street after her. But just as much as she enjoyed her stay back home, Everyone knew it was just a visit.
I think for all purposes, she's left Marietta. She's pursuing her own life in Austin, in school, and swimming, and wherever that takes her. I don't think there's anything that she would come back to Marietta for other than to see her parents and brother occasionally.
She's gone beyond small town girl.
So Betsy Mitchell returned to Austin this summer to work hard and to take time to relax and explore. Although she's grown apart from her hometown upbringing, she's finding that Marietta's traditions and values are still deeply ingrained.
I don't consider myself a major force in world swimming. You know, I'm just from Marietta, and I enjoy swimming. It's something fun, but it's not good for me to get consumed with that. It needs to be other things rattling through the empty space between my ears.
She is Betsy Mitchell, the top qualifier in the heats this morning, so she'll be in lane four.
She's a real competitor, very strong last 50 in her 200. And if she's anywhere near a competitor, she'll blow by.
The lane assignments, Mitchell in lane four, and America's Holly Green of Gainesville, Florida, right alongside lane five. Lane one at the top of your screen, eight at the bottom.
Quick start for the field. Let's not forget the East German, defending champion Cornelius Sirsch in lane three, and silver medalist in the 100 from East Germany, Katrin Zimmermann in lane seven. Americans ought to go out fast.
Is there anything we can tell about Mitchell midway through this race, where she should be if she's having a good one?
She's going to be comfortably just a little bit ahead of the field at the 100. If she's on world record pace.
All right, at the 50, John, it's Cornelia Sirsch to touch the wall first. And a time of 30.94 for Cornelia Sirsch.
You know, in the backstroke, if you get a half a body length ahead of your competitors, they lose sight of you because, of course, they're looking backwards. And so that's a real psychological boost, and Betsy Mitchell has to be mentally tough and understanding of that fact in order not to get intimidated.
Katrin Zimmermann of East Germany in lane seven is moving out in front. So the East Germans 1-2 right now at the 100, and Mitchell is not a little bit in front.
Looks like she's not where she wants to be. In fact, she came in a little bit tight on that turn, but her real strong suit is the back half of her race. We can expect her to make a move here.
Betsy Mitchell in lane four, starting to move on the leaders. Cornelia Sirsch in lane three, just in front by a head at the moment. Holly Green of the United States is in fourth.
Now she makes a big, strong move coming into the turn. They have to be going quickly into the wall in order to bounce off instead of stop and turn. They've got to recoil off the wall.
That was a good 50-meter leg right there for Betsy Mitchell. And 50 meters to go, it shapes up as another East German-America battle.
Now, I don't even know if she sees Katrin Zimmermann on her left as she comes home, but this is a very important last 50 for Betsy Mitchell.
Katrin Zimmermann in lane seven, maybe in front by a hair, and it's Mitchell in lane four, now in front of Cornelia Sirsch in lane three.
Going to be a close one. She's got to make a bigger kick right now.
She needs the kick. Betsy Mitchell of the United States in lane four for her second gold. And it is very close. Cornelia Sirsch in lane three. Betsy Mitchell will have to settle for a silver. Three coming right down to the wall, the final wall, and how get Sirsch the winner of this race by 0.02 of a second over Betsy Mitchell.
There's no excuse for that. Mitchell saw where Sirsch was. I could have probably excused her for losing to the other East German on the other side of the pool, but she knew where her competition was. Coming off the last turn, she sees Sirsch on her right. You can see her turning her head just a little bit. She knows that's her rival closest to her. She stays away from her, swims on the opposite side of the lane, not to help her at all, and it's a real strong kicking battle to the wall. Now, with 25 to go, you see the blue floats go by. She's halfway down the pool. Mitchell on the bottom in the black suit.
And she appears to have the advantage here over Sirsch.
And this is her strength. She's very good all the way to the wall. And I don't know what happened right about now. Her kick started to slow down a little bit, and Sirsch accelerated for the touch.
0.02 of a second. And there she is, Cornelia Sirsch of East Germany.
as they add another goal to their already very large total here in Madrid.
The time was not that outstanding.
That is the 13th gold medal by the East German women. The final results, Cornelia Sirch of East Germany by 2/100ths of a second over Betsy Mitchell. Holly Green of the United States finished fourth. Coming up next, the final swimming event of the World Swimming and Diving Championships, the men's 400 medley relay, an event the Americans have never lost. The World Championships. This is the relay team from West Germany as we get set for the men's 400 medley relay.
The tall guy in the middle, Mikael Gross, is having a great meet. In fact, so is his whole team. Perhaps that's why they've cut loose a little bit, dressed up, having a little fun in this last event. It's good for the spirit. It also tends to kind of discourage the rest of the competition.
Well, let's face it, as loose as the West Germans are, the Americans have been very uptight at these championships. However, today, a little bit of a change in the spirit. We've even seen the flag out for the first time. The lane assignments for the relay, the United States in lane 6, Canada the top qualifier in lane 4, the Soviets in lane 2, John, should get out to the quick start with Igor Polyansky on the first leg, the backstroke.
Soviets have a very fast first leg. In fact, he might even be going for a world record on the leadoff leg.
Each swimmer will swim two lengths of the pool. Polyansky gets such a good kick off the wall every time we've seen him here.
He certainly exploded off the start, so that indicates he is shooting for his own personal record in the middle of a relay. Any individual leg that starts from a gun and a flat start at the wall can be considered for world record status.
Mark Tewksbury of Canada in lane 4 staying right with Polyansky. The United States leadoff leg, Dan Veach, who finished 7th in the 100 backstroke here at the World Championships.
Unlike the Soviets, the Americans have relatively slow legs in the first, the backstroke in the second, the breaststroke leg, but they're very strong on the back half. The butterfly and freestyle, both individuals won the individual 100 event here at the World Championships.
So as expected, Igor Polyansky will give the Soviets the lead after the first leg. The Americans hope to stay close for the final two legs where they'll have Morales and Biondi.
That was a very quick swim for Igor Polyansky. 55-62 is an exceptionally fast leg.
Now for the Americans, second leg is David Lundberg. He did not qualify for the finals of the 100 breast. He finished 2nd in the consolation race there.
But if he can keep the Americans in the race, relatively close to the leaders, it's a very good shot for Pablo Morales to catch the leaders and Matt Biondi to go by him.
The Soviets in front, Dmitry Volkov, the bronze medalist of the 100 breast, has them in front in lane 2. Victor Davis, the great breaststroker from Canada in lane 4, has moved his team into 2nd place. And the Americans, pretty good leg so far by Lundberg. They are in 4th place.
Now the breaststroke touch into the wall and the butterfly takeoff is probably the most common cause of relay disqualifications in the medley event. You've got to stretch for the wall and make sure you touch it smoothly so that the swimmer on the block sees you coming.
Lane 3 for West Germany. Mikael Gross comes in for the butterfly. And Pablo Morales, lane 6 for the United States. The Soviets still lead, but now we expect things to change.
A lot of catching up to do. Morales is looking very good. Notice the quick recovery. He's got a very fast turnover in the butterfly. If he can keep that up for 2 full lengths of the pool, he's going to be in the thick of it.
The Americans 5th right now, the leaders, the Soviets. Alex Markovsky in lane 2 has them in the lead. 3rd leg out of 4 in the 400 meter medley, relay.
Morales' recovery, his stroke turnover slowed down just a little bit. We can see he's feeling some pain, and he's got to give Matt Biondi at least a fighting chance by getting within half a body length. Right now, they're a full second and a half behind the leaders.
They'll need another big anchor leg from Biondi like they got in the 400 freestyle. Biondi will take it into the pool, 4th place with 100 meters to go. And again, the United States has never lost a medley relay at either the World Championships or the Olympics.
Biondi's got to make up 1.2 seconds on this leg. That's a remarkable achievement if he's able to do it.
Gross put West Germany in front for a moment, but Biondi is moving up. Biondi, with 50 meters to go, is moving in on the lead. Right now held by West Germany, but here comes Biondi.
And Biondi, by being away from the action, would probably have some advantage because the water is less turbulent there.
And I've never seen a faster, more efficient kick than what Biondi's showing us right now.
He turned in a spectacular leg on the final leg of the 400 freestyle relay. He has done it again. Matt Biondi has the United States in front. The final gold medal of the World Championships goes to the United States.
Not quite a world record, but easily a world record effort by Matt Biondi in that anchor leg, going in the water so far behind, he never gave up. He halved the distance at first, and he just walked away from him on the back leg. Fantastic swim by Matt Biondi.
He acknowledges the rest of the team in the stands at the far side of the pool, and what a leg by Matt Biondi. Seven events for him at the World Championships. No, he did not walk away with seven golds, but he did medal in all seven events. Three golds, a silver, and three bronze for Matt Biondi.
Outstanding diversity through a lot of different distances, a lot of different strokes. Here's the final exchange. At the bottom of the screen, Biondi takes off of Morales' touch. You can see he's got three quarters of a body length to make up on the West German. And he starts to creep on in, rapidly kicking. You see that white water foaming off of him. And the turnover, that's the most impressive thing. He's turning over so quickly that he's not spinning his wheels. His hands come out of the water at the same point he puts them in. They flip together at the 50. And Biondi's got the endurance to go a full 200 free. Andre Schott for West Germany just can't keep up. Biondi breathing to his left. He's able to see the West German team. I'm not sure the West Germans can see the American squad, but there's really nothing they could have done at this point. Biondi holding on to that strong six-speed kick. You look underwater, you see how deep he's pulling, getting every possible ounce of surface area in the pull.
Another great leg for Matt Biondi, and it adds up to a gold medal for the United States. As the U.S. team gets the final gold medal at these World Championships. The silver to West Germany, the bronze to the Soviet Union. Dan Veach, David Lundberg, Pablo Morales, and Matt Biondi. The third gold for Biondi, the second gold for Morales at these championships. When we return, a final medal count plus highlights of other events from today's action. Centro de Natación here in Madrid. Let's get you caught up to date on the other races of this final day of competition, starting with the men's 200-meter individual medley. This is Pablo Morales of Santa Clara, California, the American record holder in this event. Morales had already won a gold at these games in the 100 butterfly, but the last couple of days had fallen under the weather. But he refused to use that as an excuse for not qualifying in the 200 butterfly. And here in the 200 IM, he did not qualify very high. That's why he was in lane two. Now at the bottom of your screen, Alex Bauman of Canada in lane seven, the world record holder in this event and Olympic gold medalist from 1984. Bauman, just like Morales, also had not been feeling up to par. He turned in a bronze medal performance in the 400 IM, also did not qualify very high for the finals of this event. But the final two legs of the 200, back came Bauman to get back in the medal contention. But the gold medal belonged to lane four, Tomasz Darnay of Hungary. He had lost vision in one eye when he was 15, unable to train for 2 years. Now, seven operations later, he finishes first. Tomasz Darnay of Hungary taking the gold medal. He had earlier won the gold in the 400 IM. Canada's Alex Bauman earned the silver in that race. We also had a new world record set in the women's 50-meter freestyle, and here's how that came about. This was the only women's event where the East Germans failed to qualify both of their women participants. But Kristen Otto of East Germany was in this race, and in lane five, she was going for her fifth gold medal, which would tie a world championship record shared by Jim Montgomery of the United States and Tracy Calkins of the USA. But with the final 20 meters in this fastest race of them all, it was Romania's Tamara Kosticki going coast to coast for the gold medal in a new record time. Jenna Johnson of the United States and Lisa Dorman also finished out of the medal count. And so a new world record for Romania's Tamara Kosticki with a time of 25:28. East Germany's Kristen Otto added to her medal count, taking second. And now turning to the men's 1500-meter freestyle, here's how that endurance race unfolded. This race represented a changing of the guard in men's endurance racing. The 1500-meter freestyle had been owned by Vladimir Salikov of the Soviet Union. But for the second time at these championships, he was beaten out by Rainer Hinkel of West Germany. Hinkel had earlier won the 400 freestyle. In lane six, Dan Jorgensen of San Diego, California, came across to add to America's medal count by collecting a bronze.
And so Rainier Hinkle of West Germany gets the gold medal, Stefano Battistelli of Italy the silver, and the bronze medal goes to Dan Jorgensen of the United States. Taking a look now at how the men's swimmers have fared here in Madrid, we see that the United States has gotten the best of this competition. Five golds, one silver, and seven bronzes for a total of 13 swimming medals for the American men. West Germany finished second in the men's competition. For the American men, the big story, of course, the performance of Matt Biondi of Moraga, California. The senior at Cal Berkeley earned three golds, a silver, and three bronzes. On the women's side, it was quite a different story, really. An astonishing performance by the East German women, who amassed 13 gold medals. That's three more than when they dominated the competition at Guayaquil 4 years ago. In addition, the East German women established five of the six world records that were set here in Madrid. One of those new world records was set by Kristen Otto, who personally accounted for four golds and two silver medals. In diving, America's Olympic gold medalist Greg Louganis turned in another virtuoso performance. He swept gold medals in both the springboard and platform events. So now let's take a final look at the overall medal count at these world championships. Now this includes medals from swimming, diving, synchronized swimming, and water polo. The United States, with 32 total medals, comes away the winner over the East Germans, who amassed 30 total medals. And these statistics really tell the story of Madrid 86. The East German women and the American women had waited 4 long years for this head-to-head contest, only to find out that there was really no contest at all, as the East German women claimed 13 golds to only 2 golds by the American women. For America's national swimming coach Richard Quick, there's plenty of work left to be done and only 2 years in which to do it before the next Olympics in Seoul, South Korea. Don't forget, next here on CBS Sports, live coverage of the final round of the World Series of Golf from Akron, Ohio. On behalf of all of us at CBS here in Madrid, these past 2 weeks have certainly been unforgettable. We hope you've enjoyed our exclusive coverage back home. For John Neighbor, Phil Boggs, and Ann Butler, and Candy Costi-Burke, Jim Nantz saying so long from Madrid.
Of CBS Sports Sunday has been sponsored by Budweiser. Each wood aged for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. STP Corporation, on the world's racetracks, on the world's roads. STP, your car care company. And by Platters, the peanuts with fresh roasted taste. Next, play continues at the World Series of Golf. Tuesday, CBS Sports coverage of the U.S. Open Tennis Championships begins with late-night highlights. CBS Sports Sunday has been a presentation of CBS Sports.